So I think in the interest of time, we probably ought to make a start. So I know we've got one or two people still arriving, and feel free to help yourself to tea and coffee throughout the morning. But just as I say, in the interest of time, we will make an official start. And most sort of importantly, of course, is to start by issuing a huge welcome. For those of you who are here for the first time, anybody who's been to our meetings over the years will be absolutely keen to let you know that this is a hugely unusual venue for us. And I feel a little bit in awe of the premises that we're in and not quite at home, but it's amazing. So we've kind of been in all sorts of hospital waiting rooms and outpatient lounges and university refectories over the years. So let's just enjoy the welcome provision for us, which we've got, of course, as part of our collaborative residency here at the Welcome Collection, because of the support group collaboration with the Created Out of Mind project. So it's good news. So welcome and introductions, of course, yourselves in the first instance, the most important people in the room as ever. If there's anything that we can do to make today run more smoothly for you, please don't hesitate to let us know. Most of you will know me as Jill Walton, and I guess we'll have been in contact one way or another in the past. More importantly than me are two people that I can't introduce in person to you. Jeanette is the lady in yellow who registered you as you arrived, and Jeanette's joined the team to provide, amongst many services, some administrative support to the Red Dementia Support Service. But Rachel, we can introduce in person, and I know that the majority of you will have had personal contact with Rachel, who joined the team in September. Rachel's a psychologist. She's worked for 10 years as a psychology assistant in various roles, and she comes with a lot of wealth and experience to add to the role here at Rare Dementia Support. So don't hesitate to direct your questions to Rachel. It's nice, really nice, to have a colleague to work so closely alongside. One or two really brief housekeeping notices. As ever, there is no fire alarm planned, so if it rings, we do need to exit via the marked stairwells. Toilets are a long way down the corridor, so kind of set off before you need it, I think, is probably the best I can say. The ladies are on the left, just before the coffee, and the gentlemen's are right at the end of this kind of atrium, again on the left, but on this level, which is a bonus. Food will be served where your coffee was provided, and again, we can have the whole use of this space, so feel free to find a table, work in small groups, however you so wish to use the lunchtime period. And then just finally, the name badges are yours, obviously, they're stick-on, but the delegate passes that you were given for access into the welcome, we do need to collect those at the end, but you need them to get out of the building. So we will try and remember to position somebody to take those from you as you leave, but if you could kind of share with us in that joint responsibility, that would be great. So thank you. I just wanted to share one or two important notices before we crack on with the agenda proper. They were to bring to your attention some of the upcoming meetings that are of particular relevance to this group, and they are all listed on the agendas which you have in front of you. So of note, of course, is the annual seminar, which is a whole day of FTD-specific presentations on the 2nd of March, and other relevant upcoming meetings Rachel has kindly listed on the back of that agenda. Hasn't. We will send an email with the upcoming meetings for your attention after this meeting. However, what I do know is happening for sure is that our artists in residence are with us today. So part of our collaborative engagement with the Created Out of Mind project has allowed us this a massive sort of rich engagement with a variety of collaborators and artists, sort of both visual and sort of musical, over the spectrum of sort of experience. And so I really just wanted to mention to you today that we have Janneke, who, if you could just kind of let everybody know who you are. So Janneke, Charlie Harrison, and Charlie Murphy are all with us today. And joining us at lunchtime is another collaborator by the name of Susanna Howard. So just to sort of, I won't go into detail about the work that they do, because that I know for sure is on your agenda in terms of the work that each of our collaborators is engaged in. But what we would hope over the lunchtime period is for each of our collaborators to have a table here, a resource table, and for you to have the opportunity to engage with them on a one-to-one basis. They will tell you a little bit about the work they're doing and the approach they're taking to the Created Out of Mind initiative, which is looking at challenging the perspectives of dementia that typically people hold. And they are working with a variety of people from the support groups, people with various diagnoses, as well as their carers, family and friends, on a range of really interesting visual and artistic projects. So please do make the most of the opportunity to engage with them today. And if you're interested in any of the projects that they're facilitating, they will provide you with the means by which to follow up and get involved. But it's a really exciting opportunity that the support groups have to engage in this new and really interesting way. Susanna isn't here, and I just speak very briefly. She will have a table too at the lunchtime session, and she is working very much with the sort of power of words and how we can use words and stories to sort of express our dementia journey, such as it is for each of us, and different, of course. Which leads me to this slide, which of course is just to make the really important reference to the fact that that journey is indeed very and hugely different for each and every one of us, and none of us know exactly what it's like to travel along a dementia diagnosis, whether that's a diagnosis that we hold ourselves or whether it's someone we love dearly and walk alongside us, a family member, a carer or professional. But what we hope is that through these engagements, through sharing time together, and hopefully through the input of guest speakers at events like this, we can all learn together and equip ourselves to walk as closely and as far along that dementia journey with the people that we're seeking to walk alongside as possible. So with that remit in mind, I want to hand over to Sarah, who very, very kindly has agreed to give us the whole of our sort of meeting allocation to come and talk us through some of the legal and funding options that are ours to consider in our sort of pathway through dementia. Sarah will introduce herself as she begins, but clearly from the slide you can see that she is the CEO of a charity called Pathways Through Dementia. One or two housekeeping notes about her presentation. As I say, she's got the morning and the afternoon slot. Whilst general questions can be addressed during the course of the presentation, if they're very sort of clarification type questions, if you have a particular question about an issue that's relevant really to your own situation, in the interest of time, that's probably best left in the first instance. One, because I know Sarah has a frequently asked questions section in which your question might be addressed anyway. And secondly, because kindly Sarah has offered not only to be available throughout the lunchtime period for people to speak to her on a one-to-one, but also to be available after the meeting, again, for sort of access on that one-to-one basis. So if we could just kindly ask that we maximise the benefit for everybody's best good and use the time as well as we can. So without any further ado, can I introduce Sarah and hand over to Sarah for the rest of the morning session? Thank you.
Thank you. Great. Well, thank you, Jill. Thank you to Rachel for inviting me here today. So I think that Jill has outlined how the sessions are going to go, but also just to say, because I will be giving quite a lot of information, I've got business cards and leaflets that have got my contact details on them. So if people want the notes, just email me and I will immediately send you a Word document of all the notes. And that will include the answers to any questions that people ask throughout the morning or throughout the day. Okay. So just a brief introduction to myself. I am the founder of Pathways Through Dementia. I'll talk a bit about how that came about. But I did have a very early experience of Alzheimer's disease within my own family. So that's me with my paternal grandfather who had Alzheimer's disease. And he had the disease for about 4 years. It was quite a rapid decline. And he died when I was 11. And then that's my maternal grandmother in yellow. And she had early onset dementia, and she probably had Alzheimer's disease for about 20 years. So from a very early age, I sort of realised that when you've met one person with dementia, you've met one person with dementia. When I moved to London about 16 years ago now, I worked at the Court of Protection, and that was really my beginning of working in this area. It was very helpful to understand how the court works. A lot of people have never heard of the Court of Protection or the Office of the Public Guardian, which does all the paperwork for the court. So this was very helpful to me to learn about lasting powers of attorney, learning about receivership, which is now called deputyship. So that was a good introduction to this area of work, because we also touched on areas like financial abuse of vulnerable adults and paying for care. I then worked in Ealing. I was an advocate for people with dementia, so I was supporting people from their diagnosis at a memory clinic all the way through, helping them with welfare benefits, paying for care, social activities. And then I started work at the Alzheimer's Society, and I worked there for 7.5 years. And I was their legal and welfare officer. So I ran a legal helpline in the afternoons, and I went out and gave lots of talks and did lots of training, mainly around the Mental Capacity Act, which was going through Parliament at the time. And that was a very good experience again, because I was just asked lots and lots of questions, and I kind of developed this specialised body of knowledge around areas like paying for care, powers of attorney, more about welfare benefits, but also community care laws that people often don't know about, don't know how to apply in their situation, in particular the Mental Capacity Act. So when I left in 2011 to have a baby, they closed the legal helpline, and the person who does that job doesn't go out and do talks anymore. So that kind of gave me an opening, and I thought I could set up a charity where that was exactly what I did. So we do have a legal helpline. The number again is on my flyers. And I go out and do talks like this and run training as part of my charity. So the main areas that we talk to people about are paying for care, role of the Court of Protection, the Mental Capacity Act and the Care Act, and welfare benefits. So we're going to start off with paying for care. Now, obviously, not everybody with dementia will go into a care home. Some people do, and I do find it's the area that people are the most interested in, that they think about and wonder about how the rules apply, what are the rules, etc. So I'll talk about that first. So essentially, these are the ways that people will pay for care in this country. If they have more than £23,250, they will be self-funding. These figures go up, by the way, every April, so it's always worth checking what the thresholds are. If they have less than 23,000, oh, sorry, that should say 250, they are paid for by the local authority. Some people will have some nursing needs and they will be covered by the NHS, but their bed and board will still be paid for by themselves or the local authority. And then there are some people who do meet the continuing care criteria, and that's when the NHS covers all costs. And I'll come on to that a bit later, because that is a frequently asked question. So, when people contact me, and in talks, this is what people often want to know about. So people still are very worried about jointly owned properties. So under the paying for care rules, if a property is jointly owned and a spouse or a partner still lives in the property, if somebody goes into care, that property is completely disregarded, okay? The other area that people wonder about is gifting money. So once somebody is going into a care home or is in a care home, how much money can they actually gift? They might have a lot of money. They might have a lot of friends and family that they want to give money to. On the one hand, they may have mental capacity to gift as much money as they like. They may have a power of attorney or a deputyship order in place, in which case that person is responsible for how much money they can gift. And there are rules around gifting. So the gift has to be reasonable compared to how much the person has, but also it has to be an occasion, so it has to be a wedding, a birthday, or a religious holiday. People often ask me, why is it that people with dementia have to pay for their own care? Why are they means tested when other people get care for free? Okay, so because people with dementia can have their care needs met by social care, so a carer who is not necessarily medically trained, they can be means tested for their care. So the law divides people into people who receive social care and people who receive medical care, and our medical care will always be free on the NHS. But if you are in receipt of social care, you can be means tested. So people want to know, how can we obtain continuing care for the person with dementia? So the best thing to do is to get hold of the continuing care criteria, and then you will see why it's quite hard for people with dementia sometimes to get continuing care. So within the continuing care criteria, there are domains. So you can have a domain for behaviour, skin care, breathing, mobility. And people have to score very highly within these domains in order to have continuing care. I did meet a gentleman the other day whose wife actually gets continuing care at home. And again, that's very rare, but it's not impossible to obtain. And finally, home care. So obviously, if you're living at home, your house is completely disregarded. They will look at income and savings, and the social services will decide what is reasonable for someone to contribute towards their home care package. Sometimes if people are paying for all of their home care themselves, they just want to sort it out themselves. They don't want the input of social services. They'll just go out there, they'll interview different care agencies and see who they feel fits them. And of course, if that then doesn't work, they can go to another care agency. If you're working with social services and they're providing the care, sometimes your options are slightly more limited. So sometimes when I'm talking about paying for care, and it is a really emotive topic, especially when people are talking about hundreds of thousands of pounds, I would say the advantage of having that money, although people do feel it's unjust that people with dementia pay for their own care, money does give you maybe more options, okay, around care. Okay, so this is the first case study that I was going to give around gifting money. This is quite an old one, but it is a true story that a gentleman was going into a care home and he sold a house for $500,000 and he bought his son a very, very expensive car. And the local authority did go after him for that money and they took him to court and his son had to sell the car and they had to give the money back. So this was in the early days when people were kind of testing the rules around paying for care, but now that would be a very black and white situation in which someone had deprived themselves of an asset, potentially in order to avoid paying for care. Okay. And then the second one, it was an unfortunate story really about a lady who contacted me, and her mother had had a fall and had decided herself to go into care. She actually lived in quite a tall block of flats and the lift was constantly out of order. So she said, I'm going to move into a care home. She didn't own that flat, but she did have £35,000 in savings. But £18,000 of that she had ring-fenced for her grandson's university fees. So her daughter called me and she said, what are we going to do about this money? Because my mother is suddenly going into a care home. This money is in her name, but technically she'd been saving this money for my son for when he goes to university. So what I usually do on my helpline is we talk through options. I will never tell somebody what to do. If you want advice, you need to go to a solicitor. That's what you're paying them for. So my charity is really about saying to people, here are your options. Now you go and do what you feel is right. So I said to her, well, your mum has capacity. She could just give this money to your son. She could do. And then she'll have to talk to the local authority about it when they discover that a lump sum of money has gone out of her bank account. Because obviously, if she's got 35,000, she'll be paying for herself at least maybe for a couple of years. If she's got less than 23,250, then she won't be. They will be paying. So they won't be very happy about this money. The daughter was actually registering a power of attorney for her mum at the same time. So in a few weeks' time, she will probably have authority to gift that money herself to her son if she chose to do so. But again, she will have to answer to the local authority if she decided to do that. The other option that they had was to talk to the local authority and say, look, this is very unfortunate, but technically this money was ring-fenced for a gentleman who's going to university, the costs of which are very, very high. Maybe the local authority would come to a compromise with them about it and say, well, he could have 3,000 or 4,000. Or the option was to simply say, it's too late now to gift that money because we know that my mum is going into care and the local authority will not be happy about this. So in a way, it's all about planning ahead. If you want to gift money, it's probably better to do it earlier rather than later, or even put that money into a trust or put that money into a bank account that's in somebody else's name. Okay, so I'm not advocating for people giving away large amounts of money, but in that situation, I really felt that genuinely this money had been saved for this gentleman, and that through an unfortunate set of circumstances, he was no longer going to get it. Okay. Does anyone have any questions at this stage before I go on to some more? Yeah.
The limit of 23,250, is that on an individual? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's okay, absolutely. So technically, really, you could be married to a millionaire. Oh, yes, sorry, yeah. So the question is, what about the partner, basically? Say the partner is earning and has a lot of savings. Is the local authority looking at a partnership, or are they looking at the person who's receiving the care, and they're looking at the person who's receiving the care? That's a really good question. And it also, I'll just mention about joint accounts, okay? So if somebody has a power of attorney registered for them, or they're a deputy for somebody, a bank will want a joint account to be split. And it's a good idea to split a joint account, because say somebody goes into a care home and at the beginning of the year, there's £100,000 in a joint account. So each person has 50,000. Then they spend 30,000. 30,000 goes out of the account to be spent on care. The local authority will then split that joint account at the end of the year. So the person who had £50,000 at the beginning of the year, who isn't receiving the care, goes from having £50,000 to having £35,000, because they will keep splitting the joint bank account. So it's a good idea to have separate bank accounts.
Can I interrupt you, Sarah?
Sorry,
just for a moment.
Yes.
Just to say, we are recording this session, and so if your questions are for Sarah, it will be really useful to use the microphone so that once we record, the whole scenario is uploaded.
Yeah. Sarah, my name is Philip. I've got two questions that relate directly to this. They're generic.
Okay.
First of all, you keep talking about the local authority splitting the accounts.
Mm-hmm.
To be very clear, as I understand it, the local authority doesn't do anything with our accounts. They simply ask us to declare the information, and then they go through the process of calculating it. They have no access to our bank accounts.
Mm.
They can simply refuse to fund the care.
If you refuse to offer that information.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The second question really is, everyone sitting here clearly is a prospective prospective access to care. But some of us might be a lot further away from it than others.
Absolutely.
At what point does the local authority, are they able to start applying the deprivation of assets type rules?
Yeah, that's a really, really good question. I would never want to say anything that made people feel that they could do something that they then did and found that there was a problem, if that makes sense. So what I mean by that is, I went to a Dementia Pathfinders information evening where I did a talk, and this is kind of worst case scenario, but just as a warning. This couple had gone to a solicitor. The gentleman had been diagnosed with dementia. The couple had gone to a solicitor, and the solicitor had said, I would strongly advise you not to be gifting large amounts of money at this point. He wanted to give his niece £5,000 for her wedding. And the solicitor would not commit to saying, yes, I think that's absolutely fine that you can do that. Now, my view personally was, this man has just been diagnosed. In all likelihood, he may never require any care, potentially, even less so go into care. My personal feeling is, at this stage, he can gift whatever he wants to gift, because the rules state it's only when you are sure that you're going to be in receipt of care that you need to be careful around your money. But then again, I wouldn't want to give the impression that people should just be gifting money as and when. So it's a very difficult one. I mean, the other question that I get asked is, how far will a local authority go back? Will they go, if they ask for accounts, if they ask for bank statements, will they go back a year, two, three, 4 years? Sometimes people come up with this 7-year idea, which is actually relates to inheritance tax. It's got nothing to do with paying for care. So my view is always, what is reasonable? I think if you've just been diagnosed with dementia and you've got thousands and thousands of pounds in the bank, I think it's personally okay to gift £5,000, but this solicitor would not commit to that. She would not commit to saying that. So people, I think, have to use common sense and decide, if someone challenges what I've done, how will I justify what I've done? And my view would be, I've just been diagnosed with dementia. There is no reason why I would be even thinking about paying for care when I gifted that money. And at the end of the day, a local authority can only get money back if they take people to court. And again, I think it's probably unlikely in that instance that they would take somebody to court. But I can't guarantee how a local authority would act.
Hello, thank you. You mentioned at the very beginning about joint property, and you said that would be discounted, but I wasn't clear what you were actually, which point you were making. So if you could clarify on that, that would be helpful.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
So basically, the paying for care rules state that in certain situations, a property is completely disregarded, so it's as if it doesn't exist. And it's completely disregarded if your spouse or partner remains in that property, completely disregarded. It's also disregarded if you have a close relative over the age of 65 living in that property, or a close relative under the age of 65 but registered disabled, or an estranged partner who is still looking after your child in the property. So they're the situations in which a local authority would completely disregard a property. Yeah, it's as if it doesn't exist. Yeah.
If you put money in trust, is that regarded as a deprivation of asset?
That's a good question. I don't talk about trusts very much because they're so complicated and you would need a solicitor probably to set one up anyway, so you would get advice from a solicitor. I suspect that if it was so easy to avoid paying for care by putting money into a trust, that's just what everybody would do. But that said, if you did it early enough, I know that some people put their houses into trust for people, and I think there is a way of doing that which can save the property. Say the property is empty when the person goes into residential care. I would definitely advise people to speak to their solicitor about that. Yeah. One more, yeah.
Excuse me, my husband is now in a care home.
Okay.
And he's had PPA for 11 years, and we're paying out of his savings, mm-hmm. £60,000 a year.
Right.
Now, his savings are running out.
Okay.
But I have savings, and I'm in the house, and I also have his pension, which I use to keep me in the house. When we run out of money, will they touch my savings?
No. Is the short answer to that, no.
That's definite, isn't it?
Yeah.
And will they then check his salary and...
They'll look at his income. Yeah, they would look at his pension or pensions if he ran out of his own money.
Yeah.
Yeah, because then they'll be paying for him. They will take his state pension, but you'll be left with 50% of any works pension that he has.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay, that's great. Okay, I think I will move on to Court of Protection now, but if anyone does have any other questions, there may be time in the second session to ask those around paying for care or come and see me in the break. Okay. So as I said at the beginning, many, many people have never heard of the Court of Protection, so when they discover that they're going to have some input into looking after somebody else's finances, they're not quite sure where to go. And there's this phrase that I hear all the time, which is called, which people describe as having Court of Protection, which doesn't really mean anything. So you either have a lasting power of attorney for somebody or you're a deputy. They're the only two ways in which you can manage large amounts of money or larger amounts of money than just welfare benefits and pension. So you can manage welfare benefits and pension with an appointeeship from the Department of Work and Pensions, but anything wider, even a gas bill, you're going to need to have a registered power of attorney or be a deputy for somebody in order to manage those things on their behalf. So usually people don't really come into contact with the Court of Protection. They're going to come into contact with the Office of the Public Guardian, and that's the Office of the Public Guardian's helpline number there. I do find them very helpful, I have to say. The advisors are very knowledgeable. They pick up the phone within minutes. So if you have any queries around powers of attorney or deputyship, do give them a call. But unless there's a real issue, you're not really going to deal with the court. You're just going to deal with the Office of the Public Guardian, and that's a civil service department. Okay. So the Mental Capacity Act of 2005 replaced enduring power of attorney with lasting powers of attorney, but I still come across people who've got an enduring power of attorney, which relates only to finances. Now, the issue with enduring power of attorney was that it was quite easy to abuse because it could be used unregistered. So people were going around with these unregistered documents, accessing other people's money and doing things with other people's money that sometimes people weren't quite aware of what they were doing. So through the Mental Capacity Act, they decided to tighten up this situation and hopefully reduce the amount of financial abuse. There was another reason that they wanted to introduce lasting powers of attorney was because there was a great demand from the public for a form that gave authority to somebody to manage their health and care as well. Because, and I used to come across this all the time, so somebody would have an enduring power of attorney, and for some reason the health professionals would defer to that person because they were the enduring power of attorney. Now, that was the health professional's choice, but legally they didn't have to do that. So you'd get people saying, the health professionals don't seem to be listening to me, although I'm an enduring power of attorney. And I'd say, well, that's because enduring power of attorney relates to finances. And they'd say, oh, no, but my next door neighbour is an enduring power of attorney for her mother, and they're always consulting with her, going along with what she wants. So there was a bit of confusion. So to make the whole system a lot more transparent and easy to use, we've now got the two forms. And I've actually brought the forms with me today so that people can have a look at them if you've never seen them before. I'm sure a lot of you have already set these up in actual fact. I run lasting power of attorney workshops now. It's taken me a long time to come up with this idea, but they're very, very popular. So every month we have a lasting power of attorney workshop. People pay £35 to come. And we just sit and go through the forms for 2 hours. There are lots and lots of questions that come up. And in actual fact, it saves people a lot of money in the long run, because I have heard people quote up to £1,000 for solicitors to help people set these forms up, which is a shame when people can, given the knowledge and the confidence, set them up themselves. So first of all, you have to have capacity to set up a lasting power of attorney. So sometimes people contact me and they say, you know, I want to set up a lasting power of attorney for my dad. And I'll say, would he understand what a lasting power of attorney is? And they say, no, he wouldn't understand. Okay, so in that case, you can't set one up. You have to set it up. It's like a will. You have to have capacity to understand what you're doing, because it's a very important authority that you're giving to people, and you must trust them to carry out your wishes. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that you can have more than one attorney. Now, you can set the forms up jointly or jointly and severally. So if they're set up jointly and you've got more than one attorney, the attorneys have to do everything together. In theory, that sounds, well, of course, why wouldn't they do everything together? Well, do they live near each other? Are they going to agree on absolutely everything? Might one of them decide they don't want to be an attorney anymore, or lose capacity themselves, or possibly pass away, in which case this form is no longer valid, because you have set it up whereby these two, three or four people do everything together. Once one person is taken out of that equation, the form is no longer valid. Whereas if you set it up jointly and severally, then people can act on their own, and if somebody walks away or for any reason can't carry out their duties as an attorney, the form still stands. So, yeah.
What do you mean by an attorney?
Oh, sorry. No, sorry, I should have clarified that. Okay, so these are all words that, again, people find confusing. So the person who sets up the form is the donor. So that's the person who is deciding who they want to be their attorneys, and their attorneys are the people who make these financial or health and care decisions for them. In about 7 out of 10 cases, people choose their partner to be their attorney. That's the most common choice. Then the next one down would be children. So people will choose one or more of their children to be their attorneys. But you can have a next door neighbour, you can have your best friend, you can have a solicitor if you wish, but solicitors will charge a fee for acting as your attorney, whereas your relative or your friend probably won't. Okay, that's a good question. So yes, so that's the difference between jointly and jointly and severally. So that's always worth people considering. Also, you might want to have different attorneys for different forms. So in my family, my in-laws are Jehovah's Witnesses. I'm not a Jehovah's Witness and my husband is not a Jehovah's Witness, but my brother-in-law is. And actually my mother-in-law has had two hip operations, which are very big operations, which may require a blood transfusion. So if she had appointed me as her health and care attorney, and I get a call from the hospital saying, your mother-in-law is in a bad way, and we would like to give her a blood transfusion, I cannot guarantee you that I wouldn't say yes. I think that I would say yes because my daughter adores her, and I just wouldn't want to make that decision about a blood transfusion, so I would probably say yes. My brother-in-law would probably say no because he is on board with her religious beliefs. Finances are a lot more black and white. You know, there's a paper trail. So the Court of Protection can always look into how someone is behaving as an attorney. But health and care decisions are a lot more grey area. So you need to think very carefully about who you choose as your attorneys. You also need to talk to them about end of life decision making as well, because that may be an area that they're thrust into that they might not want to be a part of. Human beings can be very extreme. Some people want to be 100% involved and make all the decisions. Other people want nothing to do with certain decisions. It's just how we are as people. So you could step back and say, I want the doctors to make this decision, or you could say, I don't want doctors making this decision. I want to be a person who makes this decision. That said, with a health and care form, health professionals can override attorneys, okay? So sometimes attorneys think that this gives them absolute control over health and care decisions. So for example, if a social worker said, this person is living on their own with dementia, we don't think, they've got to a point where we don't feel that they're safe. There are a couple of things that have happened and we're concerned about them. We've talked to them about going into a care home and they seem quite happy with that concept. And the attorney says, well, I'm not happy with that concept and I don't want this person going into a care home. If the social worker felt that that person was at risk and wasn't safe at home, they could not defer to the attorney. The attorney would be overridden. The attorney can complain about that decision, but ultimately, health professionals are legally responsible for vulnerable adults and they will make the final decision. So then sometimes people say to me, so what's the point then of having a lasting power of attorney for health and care? Well, it's helpful if you need automatic access to medical records. So if you were building a continuing care case, for example, sometimes people have found that they try and access medical notes and they're told you can't have access to them because of data protection, because of confidentiality. So it's very difficult then to build a continuing care case if you haven't got access to that information. Or, heaven forbid, you don't get on with a care home for some reason, you may have made a complaint about a care home. A care home then might deny you access to care plans and that sort of information. But if you were a health and care power of attorney, you would have automatic access to those notes, to those records, which can be quite helpful. It's also helpful if you've got a large family. You've got lots and lots of people with different opinions, but you've got one health and care attorney, then the health professionals can say, we hear everybody, but we're probably going to go with what the health and care attorney suggests because they've been put into that position of authority by the person with dementia. Does anyone have any questions at this point? Lots of questions. Okay.
Only a quick one, just taking the example you actually gave when we talk about the strength of the power of attorney.
Yeah.
So are you saying that if the hospital phone your brother-in-law and he says, no, do not give a blood transfusion, even though that would likely have lethal consequences, the doctors can just go ahead and give it anyway?
Well, if the doctors went ahead and gave it anyway, they would be probably open to a very serious complaint. I think when it comes to religious beliefs, then they would be at liberty to decide whether to go along with my brother-in-law or not, in actual fact, because if someone challenged them and said, why didn't you give this woman a blood transfusion, they would say, we had it on good authority that this was her wish, that she did not want this intervention, even though her life was threatened.
But is the significance there religious? Because an obvious example would be a quality of life issue, where you're saying, I know this person, their quality of life is such that I don't want whatever it is, IV antibiotics or this intervention, to take place. Again, the doctors can override that.
They could override it, yes. I mean, really, in these situations where there's a big gap in what people think ought to happen, when the thing happens, then it's only after it that people can then challenge it. So you would have a situation, I don't even know if this has ever arisen, but there may be a court case where somebody in a family said, look, this person is a Jehovah's Witness and they would not want a blood transfusion. We can prove they're a Jehovah's Witness. Probably haven't got time, but we can. And the doctors have said, well, we don't agree with it. We're here to save life. We're going to give the blood transfusion. The family might then make a serious complaint against that doctor, and it would only be the complaints procedure or the ombudsman or even a court, if they were sued, that would say whether the doctor did the right or the wrong thing. Yeah.
Thank you.
But that brings me on to another point, which is advanced decisions, which we will talk about a bit in the second session under the Mental Capacity Act. What would be really helpful would be if my mother-in-law made an advanced decision, which was signed, witnessed, and relevant, obviously, to the situation, saying, I would not want a blood transfusion under any circumstances. Now, if a doctor contravened that, he or she would be in serious trouble with an advanced decision that someone's made.
Thank you, Jill. I've got three questions, but they're all short.
Okay.
The date when EPA was superseded by LPA. I thought that was 2007.
Well, the lasting powers of attorney were brought in under the Mental Capacity Act of 2005, but yes, there was a period during which people could still make the enduring power of attorney or the lasting power of attorney. Yeah, okay. So if you're in any, if you've got a concern about it, phone the Court of Protection and say, this is the date, is it still valid?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. The second thing was, you mentioned appointeeship. I've got that because of when I was applying for disability living allowance for my wife. What are the limits of that status?
Yeah, it's limited. It's limited to welfare benefits and pension. So I think technically, I don't really come across it all that often because people tend to go for lasting power of attorney or deputyship. Mm-hmm. My understanding is that a bank would let you withdraw a welfare benefit or a pension, but obviously if you were trying to cash in an ISA or draw out savings over and beyond a certain amount, they probably would say, I'm not sure appointeeship covers this, but then you could get somebody in a bank who didn't know what it covered and just said, yes, go ahead.
Or no.
Or no, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, and you just answered the third question, which was, what was the other term as distinct from power of attorney? It was deputyship.
Yeah, which I'll come on to now.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Gosh, so many questions. Maybe I'll do deputyship in the afternoon. So if we have a few more questions on lasting power of attorney to wrap that up, and then I'll do deputyship in the next session. That might be a good idea, mightn't it?
You said in the second line there, you must have capacity. Who decides?
That's a good question.
Who makes that decision that the person has or has not capacity?
Yeah. So within the lasting power of attorney form, you have to have a certificate provider. And again, this is not a user-friendly phrase, but a certificate provider is providing a certificate saying, and when I say certificate, it's just signing the form, the lasting power of attorney form, to say, I, as an independent person, either I am a health professional or I am not a health professional, but I have known this person for more than 2 years and I'm not an attorney, I believe this person has capacity on this day to sign this form appointing this person or persons to manage their affairs. So the certificate provider does that. And I asked a solicitor about this recently. I said, what would constitute, though, somebody having capacity to fill in the form? I mean, often they don't fill in the form, actually. They just sign the form and somebody else fills it in with them. So the solicitor said, basically, in her opinion, the test for capacity is, who would you want to manage your finances or your health and care? And the person, the donor who's drawing up the form, has to be able to point to or name the person that they would want to manage their finances or their health and care. It's not really an ironclad test of capacity, to be honest with you. But the solicitor said that if she felt confident that the person was genuinely pointing out the person that they would want to manage their finances, they weren't under duress or being coerced, then they had capacity. But I suspect that there are instances in which that could be challenged, possibly. But it would only be if it was challenged that people would then look into it. This is obviously why it's helpful to go through a solicitor, because she will be, or he will be, doing a test for capacity and understands a lot about capacity issues. If you're doing it in your own home and somebody challenges it later, it may be very difficult to prove or disprove. Well, it's virtually impossible to prove or disprove whether someone had capacity on the day, unless there's incontrovertible evidence that they wouldn't have done through maybe medical records. So if somebody was in a care home, for example, and wasn't really communicating with people, and somebody had come in and got them to sign a power of attorney form, probably the staff could testify to the probability that they didn't have capacity on that day. But it is a tricky one.
Hi. Is it possible to amend the LPA once it's been produced? I'm thinking in particular about the substitute attorney, mm-hmm. where the donor has said, no, I only want one person, and then subsequently thinks that person then perhaps becomes incapacitated.
Okay, that's a good question. So on the power of attorney form, you can have replacement attorneys, which is sometimes a good idea. So under those circumstances, you could replace one attorney with another. But if you don't have replacements, and you've named an attorney and the form has been registered, that's it. The only way you can change your form now or change your mind is to revoke that form. So you call the Court of Protection and say, I've totally changed my mind, don't want this attorney or can't have this attorney for whatever reason. Then you'll have to fill in a whole new form.
So as a corollary to that, once the attorney is named, if that individual becomes incapacitated, the whole LPA becomes null and void.
Yeah, unless you've named a replacement attorney on your form. Mm.
And the other, final question. Mm-hmm. On the website, the government website, doesn't automatically produce the two LPAs. They are completely separate, mm-hmm. even though the details they say are stored and can then be used for the second one.
Yeah, that's right. So you can do the forms online, which is helpful because you can automatically track the system will automatically transfer the information from one LPA form onto the next LPA form. So if you're sitting down and filling it in, obviously you've got to do that twice. But if you do it online, it will automatically transfer that information over. So that is quite helpful. Just saves time, really. But you still have to print the forms off to sign them, obviously. Okay.
A small clarification. The enduring power of attorney, it's once you have it, it's there.
Yeah.
It's not...
You can't, no. Once it's been registered, that's fine. So I think we've just got three more questions. One, and there was a lady here, and a gentleman at the back. Yeah, that lady there. Thank you.
You mentioned that the lasting power of attorney should be done in advance.
Mm-hmm.
And at what stage does it kick in?
Okay, good question. So on the lasting power of attorney form for finances, you have two options. Either somebody can use this form while I still have capacity, or they can only use it when I've lost capacity, and you have to commit to one of those two statements. You have to tick one of those boxes. So this is because business people often use these forms when they're out of the country, or any one of us might think, oh, I don't want to deal with my finances for a while, I want a break, so I will make a power of attorney form, have it registered, but I still have capacity. It does warn you on the form that if you say, I only want this form to be used when I've lost capacity, that then wherever the attorney takes that form, the bank or the gas board or whoever are going to ask for proof that the person has lost capacity. I've personally never encountered that, ever heard of it. But it does warn you on the form that that may be the case. So it, I think what they're trying to say is it's better to set it up so that someone can use it when you have or don't have capacity. But with the health and care form, you have to have completely lost capacity to make decisions about your health and care before it can be used. So finances can be, the financial one can be used while you have capacity. The health and care form can only be used when you don't have capacity. And that's because we may need people to help us with our finances, but really, as long as we can have an input into our health and care decision making, why wouldn't we? So that's the reason. So is this, I'll come to you last. Sorry, just this gentleman and then you.
Can I just mention a word of warning about the advanced notification? Back in July last year, my wife went to a GP, and in front of witnesses, social services, nurses, everybody, all the correct people present, my wife expressed a wish if ever a situation was faced. For the advanced notification. So in front of a GP, in front of witnesses, in front of everybody, she expressed her wish. It was recorded, everything was put on file. Back in September, my wife was very ill, admitted to hospital, and the hospital said to me, we immediately want the advanced notification. Mm-hmm. Can you go and get it? Okay. I went to GP surgery, and they said, there isn't one. I said, hold on, we were there back in July and there were witnesses. They said, didn't you hear the social services had blocked your wife's wishes? There was no advance notification. The hospital was not able to put in place the care that they were going to do for my wife. Mm. They had to keep her artificially alive for weeks until enough was enough. And my advice here, and word of warning, is if anybody is doing an advanced notification, once it's in place, follow it up very, very closely to see if it has still been approved and actually granted, or whether it has been blocked without your knowledge.
Okay. Yep. And one last one. I'm very sorry to hear that. Very sorry. It was this lady in the black and white. Thanks.
I have lasting power of attorney for both lots, but my husband apparently would still be allowed to sign a check. The bank tells me that it won't do that. I say that he can't.
Okay.
And they just said, well, make sure he doesn't have access to the checkbook. That's all we can advise. It does keep people there in quite a vulnerable position, because he could have pressure put on him by another to write out a check.
Absolutely.
Can anything be done about that?
So you've registered your lasting power of attorney for finance and property. Yeah. And they're saying to you, we are still going to issue your husband with a checkbook.
Well, he has a checkbook. I sign the checks. Mm-hmm. But actually, they would honour his signature as well.
Okay. Is there anything that can be done about that? I suppose what you could do, although I don't know how successful it would be, essentially what the bank is potentially they're leaving their customer open to abuse, which they shouldn't be doing. So if a bank chooses to do that, that's very difficult. I would probably make a formal complaint about it and see what they said. And then I'd go to the banking ombudsman and say, this particular bank at this branch have told me this, and I think that they are not protecting their customer. I'm trying to protect the customer more than they are under my lasting power of attorney. But how can I do my job properly if they're saying what they're saying? And that's all you can do. And it brings up a very good point, which is that banks practice very different approaches to powers of attorney. So sometimes a bank will say, right, that's the end of a cash card, that's the end of a checkbook. And sometimes the person is perfectly safe with a cash card and a checkbook sometimes. You know, the attorney is making that decision. But if the attorney is saying this person is not safe with these things, then it's naughty of the bank to not be adhering to that, and they're not protecting their customer. Okay, I can't resist. One more, and then we'll break.
I just wanted to comment on the last question.
Mm-hmm.
If the person has a bank account in their own name,
mm-hmm.
and you have one in your joint names,
mm-hmm.
you can get third-party access to the single account.
Yep.
And, as I found last week, somewhat to my surprise, you can ring up and you can actually transfer capital from the single account in my husband's name
mm-hmm.
to the joint account. And mm-hmm. when I queried this, they said, oh, no, it's all right, because it's a joint account and his name is still on the joint account.
Right.
So this third-party access form, which does have to be signed by the person originally, actually resolves quite a lot of problems, but you have to ask for it.
You do, yeah, and the person has to have capacity to consent to having that third-party mandate on their account. Yeah. Okay, that's great. Lots of really interesting questions, and I hope that's been useful. So we're going to break now for lunch. I will be around. You can ask me questions, and then when we come back, we'll do a bit about deputyship, welfare benefits, and community care laws. Thank you.